Hi guys, Chris here. So I have with me the Xiaomi Mi Notebook 13. This is the latest model from them that has just been basically revised. So they've got now a fingerprint reader on the touchpad, an Nvidia MX150 GPU. So that's new hardware, new architecture, an upgrade over the old 940MX. And the CPU's changed. It is now the i5-7200U. 8 gigabytes of RAM, unfortunately still no 16 gigabyte option at this stage. It looks like they're not going to be doing that. Now storage options, you have 128 gigabytes of SSD storage, which I think is SATA 3, but this model here is 256 gigabytes of PCIe x4 spec storage, which should be the Samsung PM961. Otherwise known as the Samsung 960 Evo. It's basically the same car, but this is the OEM version of it. So I have my trusty handy knife here. Let's get this one unboxed and check it out in greater detail.
So it's just come in the factory double box, so hopefully it's gonna be all right. Would have personally liked them to use another box, but you can see actually, no, that's protected really quite well there. So as you can see, it has the same exact box as last year's model. They have not changed the design of that. Oh, that's ripped. So the seller of this one probably has gone in here and hopefully installed English for me. Maybe they haven't, so it could actually be in Chinese, but I guess I'll find out later on. So here we have an instruction leaflet, probably just warranty cards, things like that in here. Yeah, something similar, I think settings and all that, but that's all in Chinese. I do not read Chinese. The only other thing we have in the box is the charger, of course. So it's not a bad size, as you can see. Relatively small. And its maximum rating is 20 volts, 3.25 amps, 65 watts max. So it weighs 1.31 kilos, which isn't a bad weight at all, considering the power that this little laptop packs. And its thickness comes in at 15 millimeters. Alright, so exactly the same build as the last model. So pressing down on that lid, it feels quite firm. I don't think there's going to be any risk of that screen pressing up against the keyboard to me inside a backpack. So no changes here on the left side. We've got a full-size HDMI, USB 3 port, and then the 3.5mm headphone out, which also supports microphones, which is located in the middle there, which is a little bit odd. It would have been nice if they'd put at least an SD card or micro SD card reader on here too when they revised this model. Same goes for the right side, no changes here. So the status LED, USB 3.1 type C port, so that supports data, charging and display out all at the same time. With the other HDMI port means you can run three screens at the same time, so two external monitors and the inbuilt display. And the last port there of course is another USB 3 port. On the back, there's no ports. This part along here is plastic. That's for the wireless antenna reception and Bluetooth. So on the underside, you'll see we've got a vent here. Now this grill has the intake, of course, for the fans that are inside to help cool things down. So the air will come in through the bottom, so you don't want to block that up using this laptop on your lap. We've got AKG speakers either side, exactly the same as the previous generation, so the 2016 model. Now, because I like to look at the internals of these machines here, I'm going to pull the back cover off, and I've already taken all the screws off. So these are T5 Torx screws, and then you just pry the rear off. Okay, so I can see that we still have a 39 watt hour battery. Unfortunately, they haven't increased the capacity of that. So battery life on the last model that I tested was around about, I think it was about 5 to 6 hours only, so it's not the greatest. You can see the speakers left and right. Now we do have a PCIe x4 SSD in there. That should be our Samsung PM961. Dual fans there, they've got copper heat pipe that handles both the GPU. Right there, that's the GPU, I would say. Yeah, exactly like the other model. And our RAM is just under this shielding at the top above it. So just along there is the RAM. Now the build quality of it looks excellent. This is really good, very well laid out. And they've crammed a lot of hardware into this small and thin shell here. So I'm going to put it back together now. Oh, one last thing. If you want to install an extra SSD, you can do so right here. We've got a slot, but we don't have a screw. That's only one thing that's missing. So you could put a SATA 3 SSD like the Samsung I've got here. Screw that down into place and you can increase your storage. So you could put a 1 terabyte storage drive in there and back up all your files onto that. So it's great having this option. So no doubt you're just as eager as I am to get this open. So let's have a look and see if it will open with just one hand. The old model did. So they've got this protector over the keyboard. And you can see it looks exactly the same, but we do have, of course, now a fingerprint reader on here for added security. So I can't see any changes at all with the layout or any icons, anything like that. So we've got shortcuts for our media controls, screen brightness there, and pretty much everything you can think of. Pressing down really hard there. There is tiny little bit of flex, but I mean, it's almost next to nothing. And typing on this keyboard, as I remember on the old model, is really great. Very good keyboard to type on. So the screen, like the previous model, has glass in front of it. Now it's fully laminated, but it means that the lid is very rigid. There's a little bit of flex in it, but I mean, it's rock solid really compared to other models you see that don't have this glass on the front. Now, it hasn't been updated to a touchscreen or anything like that, which I feel is a shame because the way I see it, if you're going to put glass on there, fully laminated, make it touch as well. Why not? But I guess that adds to costs. So no changes to the front-facing camera. And those tiny little dots you can see, those little gaps either side, that's not a design flaw, as someone pointed out once on my old one. That is, in fact, where the dual array microphones are. So good to see them located here and not on the keyboard where you pick up noise from typing, of course. So time to power it up and have a look at the boot time. Now I do not know whether this is going to boot up in Chinese Windows or the seller put English on there, which I think they said they were going to do for me. So the power button is in a bit of an awkward location there. We would normally have the delete key, but the good thing about that power button is it's actually a little bit more resistant to the rest of the keys. And you can, of course, in Windows set the power button to do nothing when you press it by accident. So that booted up super quick. And I can see that, yes, it is in English, which is great. So the touchpad size is rather large for a 13.3-inch laptop. Of course, it's not MacBook large, but I found this one to be quite good. It has like a very smooth glass-like finish to it and does the job really well. And I wonder if they have pre-installed. Doesn't look like it. There should be some Synaptic software, which is very important to have, but it seems that the seller of this didn't install that, so I'm going to have to hunt that down. Now looking at the device manager, just to confirm what I've got on board with hardware. So that fingerprint reader is a ELAN fingerprint sensor. Now I've seen them on a lot of Chinese devices. That seems to be very common and it should work really well, but I will test that out in the full review. The drive, which to me, I think that is the PM961, which is great. That's a proper PCIe or NVMe drive that should have really decent performance, a lot faster than SATA 3. So it's my understanding that the 128GB model will have a SATA 3 drive and the 256GB one, of course, will be this drive. Now we've got the Nvidia GeForce MX150. I have no idea about the spec of this, but I do believe it's got 2GB of dedicated RAM, but I'll check that out also in this video here. And you can see we've got Intel dual band wireless AC, the 8265 chipset. Now this is a particularly good one because it does have that 2x2 antenna setup. And I found that using it before that it's got excellent range and speeds, no issues with it whatsoever. And there is the CPU. So it's dual core, the Kaby Lake i5-7200U. And of course it has 4 threads. That's why it's listed in there 4x. Quick look at that 1080p panel. So being 1080p stretched across 13.3 inches, you will see pixels if you look at it really, really close. But it is fully laminated glass, but that means also that it is quite a reflective display, but the color reproduction and things do look really good. It's a very decent screen. It's better than the Mi Notebook 12.5 screen that I have in the background, of course. I've compared and looked at both of them, and this one just has better whites, better colors, and overall a slightly better panel. That doesn't mean the 12.5 panel is bad, it just means this one here is slightly better and I really do quite like it. But it's a shame they didn't decide to go for maybe a 1440p screen just to make things a little sharper. And now looking at the glow around the edges that you sometimes get, that IPS glow or the IPS bleed you sometimes have, especially more so when it's fully laminated, I'm not really seeing it. Looking at the panel, it's very good. Maybe I just got lucky, won the jackpot here on the screen, that there really doesn't seem to be any bleed or issues I can see on the screen, which is great. So the memory is running at 2133 megahertz, which is correct for the KB Lake, the i5-7200U, but you notice here that it says slots used, one of two. So it's only running in single channel. This is just like the earlier model, so they're not running dual channel there, which is a real shame because we would get some more RAM bandwidth. Now I just wanted to point out that with the Windows activation, it said that I've got a digital license key that's detected from the BIOS, but it didn't activate with my current version. And I clicked on this right here, which is troubleshoot. Click on that, and then it will then communicate with the Windows 10 server. And it's told me that it has found a license on here, but I need to upgrade my Windows Edition, which might be to Pro. So it looks like we're not going to have any problems with the CD key that's in the BIOS will be working as long as you click on that troubleshooting. So I will show you a few benchmarks here because I know people want to see this straight away, this information. Just how much faster is it than the previous models? We'll have a look at the SSD speed here. Blazing fast, really good. I haven't even installed the drivers. I don't think the proper drivers from Samsung are installed there. So that could even give me a slight boost perhaps in the write speeds there, but I'm not disappointed at all with that score. That is really good. So I did run two other benchmarks here. This is to give us a rough idea before my final review. Well, I'll follow up with a lot more benchmarks here. So here's the Geekbench 4 score. We've got a single core score that is faster and the multi-core than the previous model. Now the previous model with the i5-6200, my unit got single core score of 3143. So you can see there is an increase here. And then a multi-core score of 6082. So we're up about 1,000 points here on the multi-core score, which is normal for the chipset change. So we're going to the KB Lake now. And when it comes to the compute score, this is where we're seeing a big improvement here over last generation's Nvidia 940 MX. We now have, of course, the MX150. So I don't know a lot about the MX150. I don't think there's really any information that has been published from Nvidia. But here are the speeds it's got. So you can see the GPU clocks and the turbo boost there, which doesn't really increase by much. Well, you get an extra 100 megahertz out of it. But that will, of course, be depending on the temperatures, whether it will boost up or not. Double data rate 5, it's detected those chips to be Samsung chips. And we do have 2 gigabytes of dedicated RAM for the GPU. The amount of shaders it has, so your CUDA cores, it has 384 CUDA cores. And the GPU ID, now I don't know whether this is the Pascal or what architecture that is using there, or the process, or how many nanometers that is. I'll have to do a little bit of research on that after this video and try and find out. But if anyone knows, please let us know down in the comments. And why not? Just one gaming benchmark before I release a gaming review of this laptop to check out, will it thermal throttle? What games will be playable? All right, so there are the results there. So yes, you can game Tomb Raider, Rise of the Tomb Raider, 37 frames per second average. Now that is 1080p resolution. So if you lower the resolution down to 720p, perhaps you could get away with the medium settings, but this isn't a bad result, I feel. Now, of course, this is not a gaming laptop. Just want to make that clear, but it's good to see that we will be able to play games on the side. So the fans are on 100%. I'll give you a sample of that in the full review, but just to say now that yes, it is loud, you can hear it, but it's not an annoying fan noise. So I'm going to have a look now just very quickly at the surface temperatures, because this is one of the things I was concerned about and didn't particularly like on the old model. So it's already up to 41 degrees. Now, 42, 44, that is where the vent is along the top here. 45, that is quite hot to the touch. That I would class as not scorching hot, but it's getting up there. That is actually almost scorching hot. So if you intend to game on this for long periods, you probably want to use a laptop cooler or at least prop it up, because it is sitting down a little bit too low, I feel, affecting the airflow. So just like the previous model, the same speaker configuration, they're downward firing, they're AKG tuned. Let's have a listen to how they sound. So as you can hear from that there's bass, there's mids, and some treble in there. They're not bad sounding speakers at all, considering how thin this notebook is. So this is what the keyboard looks like when you're using it at nighttime. It's well lit, but we do not have any control. So there's no variable different levels. It's either on or off. And after 13 seconds, it will turn itself off automatically to save the battery. Right guys, so that's it for this video here. This is just my unboxing and first impressions are overall, really, it's just the same laptop as expected, but we've got a more powerful chipset in there with the i5-7200U in there. So you're getting around, I think it's about 14% more or something like that, 10 to 14% more performance. And then the GPU does look to be quite a bit more powerful. Now my areas of concern are, of course, the battery life. How long are we going to be able to get out of this? Because it wasn't that good at all on the previous generation. Perhaps it's a little better here, but I'm not expecting anything miraculous with only a 39 watt hour battery inside this. But that'll be coming in my full review along with more benchmarks, thermals, will it thermal throttle? I will check that out using Intel XTU to have a look and see if we're going to run into power limit issues. We probably will, and of course the thermals and things, just how hot is it going to get? Because that was one area that I wasn't too happy about with the previous model, that it could get really scorching hot when you pushed it hard encoding 4K video or gaming, that really it became a little bit unbearable to touch it, and then the fan noise would really kick right up on 100%. But that'll be all coming in the full review. Besides that, the build quality is excellent. It's got a great backlit keyboard on there. Touchpad so far seems just as good as the previous model. I don't think they've made any changes there. And the screen too, yeah, is very good. Nice panel on there. Even though it is 1080p, it's quite a decent one there. But overall, it is a premium laptop and great that they've put so much power into such a small form factor. And we do get that free SATA 3 SSD slot depending on what model you get. I wish more manufacturers would do this. So I hope to catch you back in my final full review. And there will be an extra additional gaming review of this particular laptop just to see what kind of games we can play with what settings. Thanks so much for watching. Bye for now.